Peace, y'all. Before we start this episode of Real Notes, I wanted to let you know that my first book ever, Real Notes, Culture Writing on the Margins of Music and Movies, is out right the fuck now. That shit feels so crazy to say. About two-ish years ago, my good homie Austin Williams approached me about writing a primer on the worlds of digital journalism, criticism, and how they interact for his journalism students, and naturally, I jumped at the opportunity. This book is part autobiography, part journalism textbook, and part essay collection spotlighting some of my earlier work, particularly from my old stomping grounds over at djbooth.net. This industry has always been unstable, but with layoffs and general consolidations happening at publications all over, this book feels more pertinent now than it did while I was writing it. And while it may be for students, anyone who's a fan of writing, music, film, and this podcast, of course, will appreciate it. The book is only available digitally through the Kindle app and through the Amazon link below. So go to Amazon, search for Real Notes, Culture Writing on the Margins of Music and Movies, and just add that shit to your collection, man. No, you don't need to have a Kindle in order to read the book. Either download the Kindle app or you can access it through the Amazon one-click link. So many people have been asking me, like, you don't need to own a Kindle. I promise I wouldn't do that to y'all. Just, like, grab the book if you can, if you're able. Good looks if you can. I really appreciate your support and consideration. It means the world. Now let's get back to talking. What's good, y'all? My name is Dylan Green, and this is Real Notes, a space dedicated to blurring the cultural and artistic lines between rap and film. I'm here to chop it up with everyone from rappers and producers to journalists and video directors about their relationship to movies and how, if at all, film inspires their craft. My guest this week is New Jersey rapper, poet, producer, and singer MoRuf. We spoke about Top Boy, I May Destroy You, Higher Learning, the filmography of Spike Lee, going from battle rapping and poetry to pursuing music full time, why he waited a decade to fully commit to making music his career, the power of community building, and the creative process behind his latest project, Tiny Mike Raps Volume 1. Come fuck with us. What's cracking, everybody? Welcome back to Real Notes. It's warm out. It's officially spring. Spring took a little while to get here, and I don't know, like, niggas had snow in fucking New England like 3 days ago. So I don't know what anything is anymore. We're out here. Dylan Green, CineMasai, got a lot of names, do a lot of shit outside, inside, all sides. I'm with somebody else who's also all over the place. He be jet setting like crazy. I have no idea how he goes between the East and West Coast as often as he does. This is our first time talking for real, but like, wow. I've been a fan for a while. Just learned recently, fellow Jersey native.
That's Big Jersey.
Fucking crazy to me, you know, like not exactly neighbors, but you know, Irvington to Montclair to Clifton, you know, close enough.
15 minute drive.
Yeah. But you know, we got, you know, rapper, singer, extraordinaire, fucking, we got MoRuf here. MoRuf's in the building. Finally,
peace. Yeah, man, it's good to my Jersey brethren. All honesty, the fact that I'm just finding out you're from Jersey, just like I said it earlier, like shit warms my heart, my nigga. All honesty, you know, because you don't really meet, you know, a lot of folks. Now it's a handful, like I said, Topaz, Thelonious.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, peace.
Yeah, man. Yeah, no, thank you for being here. And yeah, obviously, shout out to Topaz and Thilo. Topaz has been on here. Thilo hasn't yet. We've been talking about it. Maybe it'll happen at some point. But those are my boys. Right. Seen them grow. And yeah, you know, like you've been out here for a good long minute, and it's been incredible to see you. It's been incredible to see you like get to the point where you're at. Like, I remember the first time I heard your verse on the song with Quelle and Sifu. And it just warmed my fucking heart, man. Like,
you know what's crazy? I was listening, not even for conversation sake. I swear to God, bro. I was listening to it last night because I was listening through like my top, you know, listens, and I'm just and that popped up, and I'm just like, we kind of went crazy on this. You know what I'm saying? But yeah. Shout out to Brother Quelle and Brother Pink, man. Those are brothers, man.
Yeah, nah, man. They're legends, and you're a legend, bro. Like it's really been wonderful to like dig through the discog and like go back and miss and listen to all the old shit I missed, and just like see what you've built and see you here now.
Shit is crazy. It's kind of crazy. As long as I've been doing it, kind of it feels like it's only begun. Oddly enough, it's weird, bro. It's fucking weird. But yeah, man.
I get it, man. Yeah, nah, like I think about that sometimes in myself too, because I've been doing this for about a decade, and I also feel like I'm just getting started. But you know, like
it's crazy.
But before I forget to say it, Tiny Mike Raps Volume 1 out now everywhere.
What you talking about? Of course.
Listen, come on now.
Do I got the mic on me? Hold on, I might have it.
Oh shit!
I might have it on me.
Wow, is that the one? People can't see it because this isn't video, but like, nah, damn. Cool.
Nah, but I stay with that thing on me, of course. But yeah, that's the Tiny Mike. Yeah, but Tiny Mike Volume 1 is out right now. Indeed, man. It's been 3 weeks. It'll be a month on Friday. Sheesh, that's wild.
Damn. Wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Then I caught you at the perfect time.
Yeah. Perfect. Perfect.
So let me ask you the first question I ask everybody who comes on here, which is what was the last movie or TV show you watched that you had a strong opinion about?
Damn, you talking right now. I don't want to be basic, but fuck it, I'll be basic. I'll say Top Boy.
Cool. How you feel about Top Boy?
Yo, like, that's the reason why I call niggas bruv. Home. You know what I mean? Like, I wish I had a London accent so bad. Like, badly. Is this something, you get me? Like, that's natural. I didn't even mean to say you get me.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
Dead ass. But Top Boy, you know, just simply, spoiler alert, you know, how it ended and fucking Sully and what he did to Jamie and what whoever did to Sully. It was, you know, it had the group chat going crazy. So I think, you know, that was probably one of the last things that kind of had me going nutty in the group chats. Probably, you know, the last season of Top Boy for sure.
So I watched the last season of Top Boy when it came out. I love Top Boy. I thought it was great until the end. Didn't love the ending. Like that last season was kind of rocky for me personally.
It was a little nutty. And you know, what's Jax? I think that's Shorty's name.
She was my favorite character, bro.
I'm gonna be honest. She was the star. She was actually the star of the last season. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
And I think she might have off Sully, but it's just the fact that I'm speculating and their conversation is speculating and their fucking blogs or who killed them. I think that is the true definition of a great, you know, story, or even, I wouldn't say a great ending, but the fact that people are speculating or even angry, I feel like that's a sign of a good fucking narrative to a certain degree. You know what I'm saying? It could have been better certain parts here and there. I was trying to tell niggas that Jamie's still alive. Because they didn't, I know he shot him, but they didn't say, like, maybe the nigga on life support. But once I watched the last season, I was like, yeah, that nigga dead. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Because I was, so I remember exactly where I was when I saw Sully kill Jamie, and I was just like, because it's crazy, because you could argue that, like, Jamie was the star of the show for that last season, like, right before he got off. Like, he was the one. So I was like surprised, like, really, you're gonna kill Jamie right now? I mean, obviously, like, Deshane and Sully are the two dudes who, like, they started everything off, and like, they were they were over at Summer House in like the first series, and then like, Jamie and Jax are like the two young guns coming up. But like, I was like legit blown that they decided to kill Jamie so soon. I was like, we're not even gonna let him ride out like the next season. Like, I was a little mad about that.
I was heartbroken, but I'm thinking, was it awesome? Like, because that nigga's career was low key taking off. I don't know, because the nigga, who knows?
But he's been also everywhere. You're not wrong. Yeah.
But also, something I did not like, I'm not gonna hold you, the fact that Sully killed Deshane.
Yeah.
You didn't have to kill your mans. And it wasn't even an intentional kill. It was like the nigga was running, so he just threw a shot. But it was just like,
wasn't he like blind shooting like over the wall or something? Yeah, right.
But it was still goofy. Like, let the nigga fucking go to Russia. You feel me? It was like, Sully, you're fucking goofball for that. You feel what I'm saying? Like, that's your man. But anywho, shit gave me in my feelings. But yeah, that was, man. Top Boys definitely was one of those ones. And a reminder why I need to head out overseas. I got to go to London.
I feel you. Yeah, no, like, after watching the whole show, like, I've been wanting to go to London for years. But, like, you know, just kind of thinking about the, because like I talked about this with a few people. My homie Kemba, shout out to Kemba, he's also a huge Top Boy fan, and we talked about it like right when the season ended, and like he and I talk about this sometimes, but just the idea that like New York and to an extent Jersey, like there's a lot of similarities between like our area and London, like
I just see that.
Like just like the tri-state, like in terms of like the fashion, in terms of like the slang, and of course, and you're like, of course, like the diasporic overlap between like the Caribbean and Africa, yes. Like, you know, like that, like it's, that's a big part of the reason why I've been wanting to go over there. Also because apparently they call, what do they call they call ATMs cash points. And that's cool as shit to me. That's like some video game shit. So like, I just want to be in the area where somebody's like, I got to go to the cash point and I'm going to laugh. And they're going to be like.
But you know why else I think I fucked with Top Boy? Because, you know, I was a little used to watch The Corner and The Wire. And I wasn't like OD fond of The Corner and The Wire. I tried to rewatch The Wire recently. And I guess it was so slow for me personally. I'm just like, maybe I'll revisit it. But I guess Top Boy, and you mentioned it, had that diaspora, you know, like these niggas was Jamaican, Nigerian, African, and I mm-hmm. felt connected to it, low key. I never moved a drug in my life, you get me? But
right.
I felt very connected to the narratives, like hearing a mom have a Nigerian accent reminded me of my aunt type energies.
Right.
And also just to see the subcultures, of like the energy in the world out there, it was like so different, but I still felt so fucking connected as well, you know.
Yeah, you know, I don't know, you just don't see very many like depictions, because when most people think about London, I feel like it's taken about like a decade and change for people to like for like Americans specifically to understand that there's like more to the UK than just like white people in like period pieces and shit, like
and crumpets,
people,
yeah,
right? Yeah, yeah, you know, I think people are finally starting to wake up to that, and I think I don't want to say Top Boy is like the reason that is. I mean, for some people it is. Like there are some people who never would have even thought about that until they watched a show like Top Boy. But you know, like I think it's like a smaller piece of like a bigger, just like, you know, like between like. Cause you know, like the second wave of drill came out of the UK, and yeah, obviously, yeah. Like it goes even further
Grime,
back than that.
I'm
like
just saying, it's just
right
it's the grime scene. It's in it, yeah. Which is basically
jazz and soul, and all
you
that
get
shit,
me.
Yeah.
And even like other shows, like the UK humor. This is one other show I just binge watched. I'm so tight that I forgot the name of it, but it's basically it was giving me like the black version of Issa Rae. He's basically a writer. He's based in London. He's a writer trying to shoot his fucking script. It was on, it's on Paramount. I'm gonna send it to you after, but it's so
please
fucking good, bro. I'm so mad I don't know the name of it right now, but it was so good. It was so good. It was like the male version of Insecure. And the reason why I'm saying that is because, you know, it was like modern, you know, I got it. It was so good. But more over the point I'm trying to make, the stories that they tell and the writers, I really love the viewpoint that London and overseas is getting, you know, for sure, for sure. It's refreshing, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that and before we move on, you ever watch I May Destroy You, Michaela Cole's show that was on HBO?
Nah. You put me on. Nah, I got to tap in.
Yeah. So,
okay.
It's kind of sort of like Insecure, but it's a little more raw and a lot. It's more raw and more intense. I don't really.
Yeah.
It's also about like it's about a woman. She's a writer. She got like a book deal off of being like a Twitter personality, and she gets assaulted in a bathroom, and like that kind of causes her life to unravel. Like it's one of those that has like a it's got a premise that's easy to explain, but then you like go watch the whole thing and it just unravels in this Like it's pretty wild. I liked it a ton. I've actually been meaning to go back and rewatch it recently, but I really loved I love Michaela Cole's. Because she made that show Chewing Gum, in the UK. I want to say like 4 or 5 years ago too.
Yes. I love her. I love like her facing structure, and she's funny as hell. You know, she's great. But I got to tap in. Okay.
Yeah. And if you remember the name of the other show, you got to tell me later because I definitely want to.
Bro, I'm
always looking for other shit.
I was just trying to look for it now, but the service is so ass. But I'll send it after this though.
No worries. Let's go all the way back with you in that case, son. What's the first movie experience you can remember having? It could be at the theater. It could be at your cousin's house. Like the first thing that comes to mind for you.
My first movie theater experience I can remember is Higher Learning.
Yeah, wow. Okay, let's talk about it.
It was intense because I probably wasn't supposed to see it. I think I was like 8, 9 types of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like a small independent movie theater in Irvington. Shout out to my cousin Dara. He brought me and my sister to see it. And it was, bro, man, it was a. I rewatch it often, because this number one, the how they were able to capture, you know, the culture, you know, just in an amazing light from, you know, Lawrence Fishburne character, Ice Cube character, Omar Epp. It was, bro, and it was intense. Obviously, like the white nigga killed Tyra Banks. It was intense. It was like a race war. It was so intense, bro, and I did not truly appreciate it until I got older and I actually saw how prevalent and still relevant it is, being a tall black man in America type shit, you know what I'm saying? But it's so fucking good, bro. It's still so good. Like, it's so many sound. I took a sound bite for the album. I threw that shit in it. It's so good, but it was fake traumatizing because it was like, oh shit. Like how he offed himself at the end type, type vibe. But just the narrative and story of like, I think what I loved about the movie so much that, you know, everyone had their own little narratives. Like Omar Epps, he had his narrative. He trying to figure out the track shit, thinking he a star. I forgot the white John. She had her own little narratives, trying to find herself, her sexuality. And obviously, what's the white boy? He's that guy.
Michael Rapaport. He's the worst. I hate him. Michael Rapaport.
We all do. Respectfully. The fact that he directed the Tribe Doc got me hot, but we'll talk about that later.
I was just thinking about that last night. Sorry. Anyway.
I watched that often too. But moreover, just even his narrative of like, because it was really, as I rewatch it, it's just really a quest of young individuals trying to find themselves and how influence, you know, that left turn can be the turn that can change your life for the best or change your life for the worse. It's such a great film. It's such a great film. Such a great film. Man. One of my favorites.
So I haven't, so it's been some years since I've seen Higher Learning. So the two things, I mean, like I also think it's really cool. I love the soundtrack. I just learned recently.
Oh my gosh.
I wrote a thing about Rafael Sadiq last year. I think I reviewed his first solo album. His first song as a solo artist was on the soundtrack for Higher Learning, which I didn't realize until recently.
That's crazy. His first
solo? Like his, you know, his first like on the first solo song like he made, like right, I think it was right before he left Tony.
That's important.
Just for that, the soundtrack goaded. That and I almost wanted to say that was the first movie I ever saw Busta Rhymes in, but it's actually not, because I think I saw him in Halloween Resurrection before I saw Higher Learning for the first time.
Okay.
He was crazy. Like him and wasn't Ice Cube in Higher Learning too?
Cube, yeah, Cube was in it. He fucking killed it. No. Yeah. Cube was in it.
Okay. And then for me, the only thing that kind of gave me pause was like Lawrence Fishburne's Jamaican accent is so bad, bro. It's so bad. It's so bad.
I guess I've seen the worst because I saw clips of this recent Marley movie.
I get it.
I've seen worse recently. But I definitely feel you. It was a little trash. Yeah. But shout out to John Singleton, you know, and
yeah,
you know, even it. Like I recently rewatched Poetic Justice. Me and wifey, what was that, on my birthday or Valentine's Day? We went to go see it outdoors or some shit. But anywho, it was I'm not gonna hold you. I wasn't the biggest fan of it until I saw it again recently, and also the reason why I love Spike, their ability to capture the culture and put it on the big screen is phenomenal. And I think that's why people love Issa so much, is because like her ability to capture the culture and put it on the big screen. We don't have a lot of that shit, bro. Like, think about it. How many fucking Gaia learnings do we have right now, bro? How many Poetic Justice, you know, shout out to Calmatic for the remakes. I appreciate that and everyone else, you know? But it's just like, we don't have, like, that's why I really cherish this. It's like, damn, like, a Black director who was able to really capture the culture wholeheartedly, bro. You know what I mean? That shit gave me my feelings right now. They were like, you know, he did it so well. Even with Baby Boy, you know, say what you want.
Yeah.
But he captured it so, and it's, you know, you say what you want about Tyrese, what more do you want from me? But it's a fucking cult classic, bro. It's a cult classic. Bro.
Easy. Yeah, nah, it's like I've been thinking about that over the last like year and a half. Like to me Baby Boy was always kind of overhated. I've always loved Baby Boy. I think it's great. It's not a perfect movie, but like it you know, like it does what it needs to do. And you know, like I don't know, man. Singleton got it, you know, like Singleton and you know, like he's like neither Singleton nor Spike has a perfect track record when it comes to all of their movies. Like Spike made a whole decade of trash, like from the whatever came right after Inside Man. Girl Six. But see, Girl Six is not a good movie, but I love watching Girl Six. Like it's not a good movie, but I will watch it if it comes on.
Like it's like Belly. It's like Belly for me. Like I put on Belly on you, respectfully, at the studio. Belly's on me. You know what I mean? But I feel like recently Spike he made up with the Five Bloods.
Definitely, I agree. I fuck with that a lot.
He killed that. Even how like they had Chad character coming back and him passing, it was. You know what I mean? But you're definitely right. Them niggas don't have the most perfect track record. You know what I mean? But what Legends does.
But you know, like to your point, like they did get the culture. They like, you know, like they put it up, they put it up on the screen in a way that like everyone's really trying to get at, like to this day. And I'm really happy that you kind of put Issa Rae in that lineage, because I think she's like, you know, like people like I stopped watching Insecure maybe around season 3, but I think like give it like another 5-ish years and people are gonna start going back and being like, you know, like Insecure was an important thing. It kind of brought people together and showed it kind of like, I kind of feel like she's carrying the torch for like the Black millennials right now in terms of like what their experience is, even if like I kind of stopped watching and stopped caring after a while. Like she's definitely a figure that we need to like, you can't count her out. And you're like, I think that she exists within that same lineage as people like Spike and John. So definitely.
No question. And even to that point, and I might be gassing it, but shit, I put Quinta right under Issa right now because my G, what the fuck she's doing with Abbott? My God, I can watch that with wifey. I can watch that with my niggas. I can watch that with my mother. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, and it's even her capturing the culture in it. You know what I'm saying? Like Zach Fox and the ball from Everybody Hate Chris. It's just like the guest. This it's like,
yeah, you know,
and
yeah,
that's and that's what I realized when I do go back to the films that I love, you know, the common denominator was their ability to capture the times. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I think she is doing an immaculate job at it. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to Quinta as well.
Yeah, nah, definitely. You know, like between like Quinta and Issa, you know, like they exist within the lineage of people, you know, like Dream Hampton and Gina Prince Bythewood and all these other like wonderful Black women who've like made all these incredible films and documentaries and all this writing. I don't know, man. Like I could sit here and rattle off names all day, but just to like, you know, like I see that through line between, you know, just like authentic capturings of either like the culture or just like the times or like the way we, and you know, like Michaela Cole, she's in there too. So, you know, like, I think it's really important to note that there's like, you know, like they're all a part of a lineage, and I'm happy that we're kind of like bridging those nodes or like making those bridges right now.
Life but life, especially, hell yeah, son.
So like as you get older and you start having more life experiences and you start to, you know, like obviously like you're basking in culture more as you get older, like was there a movie that kind of, what was the first capital M movie you saw, like something that stopped you in your tracks and really like spoke to you in like an emotional or artistic or spiritual way, like something that was like more than just 90 minutes of entertainment?
Damn, fuck. I'm trying to think outside of my goats. Jeez.
You can keep it in your goats if you want. It's up to you. Yeah.
I'm gonna say two. The first one was In Too Deep.
Okay. Good choice, man. Wow.
Omar, and the reason why I say that is because, like I said, I'm a huge fan of the fucking culture, and I'm a huge fan. With that being said, I'm a huge fan of LL, and I'm gonna be honest. I really think niggas slept on his performance in that film, like my G. And I'm from Jersey. We're from Jersey, but like I think I know the individual. Are that he actually was playing, like it's lightly based upon the true story, and I've seen the nigga that he played type shit, so it's just like I felt connected to it. And even like, you know, just the fact that his character was able to play villain, but he still had the heart and even to like open up his heart to Omar, or even to do the Turkey Day shit, you know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, he killed that nigga and threw him in a dumpster and put the pool stick in his butt. Pause. It was just the dynamic of a human of like, you could be like the most loving individual, and that same loving individual could be a villain. And I saw that movie also at a young age, and I probably wasn't supposed to see it.
Right.
But I'll say In Too Deep, and the second one that I saw a little older and plays a huge role of me falling in love with jazz, well, all his movies with Mo' Better Blues.
Yeah, cool. Underrated Spike movie.
I thought I was bleak at one season of my life, and I'm happy that I realized I am not.
You don't want to be bleak. Anybody listening, you don't want to be bleak.
Nah, you don't want to be bleak. You know what I'm saying? But he was torn, you know, and it was the conflicts of a man. And but it was an amazing movie, and it's something in which I go back to heavily, you know, to this day. And it's my mood board.
Man. Right. Yeah. I mean, I get it, you know, like between the outfits and the music and just like all the performances are crazy. Like that's to me to me, I think that and Do the Right Thing are the two best looking Spike Lee movies. Like the cinematography and like the color, yes. and the color grading, like the suits. Like I love the way Mobetta Blues looks. It's so funny. I just had somebody else. I have my homie Shamar on here maybe like a month-ish ago, and we talked about Mobetta Blues. He's he's younger than us, and he just saw it for the first time. So we we spent like a good 20 minutes just talking about like how he felt about the ending and just like, you know, like obviously like Bleak, you know, like Bleak gets humbled because his lips get fucked up and then he can't play the trumpet no more. And then to me, one of my favorite parts of the movie is how like the ending parallels the beginning where like his dad makes him practice instead of going outside. And then he looks at his son and he's like, you know what? Nah, fuck it. Go outside. Like go like. Like the horn will be here when you want to play it. It's like him having to be like, I don't need to live vicariously through my son like that. You know, like if he wants to do it, he can do it. But like, just like him making that choice to live his life and, you know, like hopefully be a better person. Like, you know, like, like I was saying earlier, like you don't want to be Bleak, but like Bleak is such a compelling character because of like, because of like how magnetic his personality is and just like he's Denzel, like Denzel always does that, but like, you know, like he's so compelling because of that arc, you know, like he grows kind of, you know, I haven't watched Mobetta Blues in probably like 5 or 6 years, so I think like in the next 2 days I'm gonna need to run it back. It's been time, son.
I'm not gonna hold you. I recently watched it probably November. And my nigga, it's still so fucking good. Like you said, visually, it's amazing. And also, it's star fucking studded. You get me?
Yeah, bro.
Like, one of my personal goats, Wesley, he's one of my personal goats. You know what I'm saying? And he bodied that character. Like, whoever did the wardrobe, god damn. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I think it's like, my fault, what you about to say?
No, you're good. Keep on.
And as I get older, I realize the conflict of it. And, you know, Bleak was on his discipline shit. And I feel like, you know, he almost allowed his wants, you know, to, like, ruin his life, you know?
Right.
And it's deep, bro. It's deep as fuck.
Yeah, and there's, like, this has nothing to do with Bleak, but there's I mean, like we all know Spike's known for the dolly shot. Like that's his like iconic thing. Like I think it's funny because I think Mobetta Blues has my favorite Spike Lee dolly shot in it ever. It's the one right after Spike gets the shit beat out of him and he's got like his hand gets fucked up and he's got like the brace a claw or whatever. And like it's just like a close up on him on the dolly. And it's just like him, like his hands in front. I don't know. Like there's something about like the way that shot was composed. Like I think about that shot all the time. Like it's just so ill. Bro, I don't know why, but
it's so important. I say my favorite Spike Dolly shot movies would be that I know exactly what you're talking about because Spike had the brown jacket, the top hat with the fucked up hair. That one
and the
Girl
Maze,
6
yeah.
Dolly shot. The Girl 6 dolly shot, when Shorty, I guess he was going through it, and it was the lighting was red and green. That shit was crazy. And I think there was a dolly shot, but I'm not sure if it was a dolly shot because, like, they actually, like, elevated. So it was like, it started off dolly, but it kind of went up. But, yeah, man. See, that's, like, Spike is, like, even with that, that's the thing. Like, I take from even Spike having a dolly shot and a good majority of his movies, and I try to even implement stylistically, even within my music. You know what I'm saying? It's just like he has like a signature residue, if that makes any sense. And it's just
totally
he's him.
Yeah.
He's him, bro. He's him.
Before we move on to the music, like I talk about this all the time, like especially recently, but like I can't tell you like once again, Spike's not perfect, but like that front half of his career like everything from like School Days up until Bamboozled is just like insane. Like those movies are just like even Girl 6 to an extent, even though like it's not like the best movie he's ever made, but like he's just to me, like I've been thinking about it. If I had to pick my three favorites of his, I would say Do the Right Thing, More Better Blues, and Bamboozled. Like Bamboozled fucking changed my life. Like that was like that movie shook me to my fucking core when I first saw it, you know? And that's one that I think more people need to watch.
I have to rewatch Bamboozled. I'm not gonna hold you. I haven't probably seen Bamboozled in like 10 plus years. I have to rewatch Bamboozled. But here's a sleeper spike flip. She Hate Me.
So I put She Hate Me in the same box that I put Girl 6 in. It's not a good movie, but I love to watch it. Yeah.
Yeah, like
that movie's a riot.
Q-Tip killed it.
Q-Tip
killed it. I think that was the era when he was tapping into his acting. What's the Q-Tip movie of which he pushed that girl on the train tracks?
Prison Song.
Tip was high.
Yeah,
it's
nah,
a few,
man.
It's a few rappers I wish kept going. Like Tip was great, Busta was great. You know, it was a few niggas who were great, but it was a few niggas who I'm happy they stopped too. But yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. It's funny you bring up Prison Song because for the season premiere of the pod, I had my homegirl Miss Boogie on, and we talked about Prison Song. So that movie's still fresh in my head. Oh, wow. I hadn't seen it for a minute, and Tip was excellent in it. The whole cast is really good. Like I think the thing that always gets me about Prison Song is that it's like really stagey. I forgot that it's basically a musical. And like you could tell that like they really structured it like it was a play. Yo, my fault. Sorry to interrupt, but I just wanted to shout out the all new Real Notes Patreon page real quick. If you're looking for ways to connect and directly support the podcast, the Real Notes Patreon is the best way to do so. For as little as $5 a month, you can gain early day before access to every forthcoming episode of Real Notes, as well as an invite to the Real Notes Discord server. You can talk to others about the latest and greatest in movies and music, come through for some listening sessions, and talk about whatever else is on your mind. I know I'm gonna be talking a bunch. If you feel like coming up off a little bit more, you could get cool exclusive content, like audio from Real Notes Live and Real Talk interviews. Those will be exclusive to patrons and ticket holders moving forward. Access to retro versions of my 60-second Minute Maid movie reviews, and even a monthly writing and podcasting workshop hosted by me. Regular episodes will still be available on a weekly basis anywhere you get your podcasts. But if you want the extras, you gotta come out them pockets a bit. Check us out at patreon.com/realnotes. That's R-E-E-L-N-O-T-E-S. I appreciate your consideration and support more than you know. Now let's get back to talking. So the rhythm felt kind of weird sometimes, and like the way that like the lines were read felt kind of weird sometimes. It was like a little stilted, like in the way that like all plays and musicals are, but the performances are all so good, and the story's so like it's watching Tip get shot in the prison cage like at the end. Bro, and then like to see the people at the art exhibit.
The ending is some bullshit. Like talking about it gets me hot. You get me? Let's stop talking about it because I'm mad. Like what? Like, but also that's the thing, bro. You know what I'm saying? It's just like I love a good film. It's like back to the top boy. It might not have been the end of niggas is like, but I rather, you know, it evoke emotion. Years later, I'm still tight about it. You know what I'm saying? Getting connected, like why, nigga? You know what I'm saying? But it's just like that's to me. That is as I'm getting older. That's when I'm realizing, like my nigga, that's art. That is art when you disagree with the shit. You might not agree with the shit. Why did the writer whatever? That's art to me. You know what I'm saying? Well, everything's art, but that's the art that I really do appreciate as I mature and get older, that you, you know, something that evokes emotion. It's fucking amazing. It's fucking amazing.
Yeah, not, yeah, cause like like I'm pretty much the same way. Like I would much rather really love some shit or really hate some shit as opposed to being like, eh, it's whatever. Even if you don't love it, like at least it like got a reaction out of you and you can at least like articulate why you don't like it. Like that's cool, you know, like that's at least like constructive. But like if it's just something that's like, yeah, I was all right, you know, like I won't remember this in 12 hours. Like, what are we doing here? You know?
Exactly. quick, just a quick sidebar. I watched this movie on the plane on the way to Jersey, starring Nicolas Cage. Have you seen Dream Scenario yet?
Oh, yeah. No, I saw Dream Scenario when it came out last year. How'd you like it?
Bro, see, that's another movie, like, talking about evoking emotion. Like, I was on my toes, because you remember when he went to like link up with the Young John?
Yes.
And I thought she was going to out him for the remainder of the movie, but like she was just that moment. You know what I'm saying? So it was just like certain aspects of the movie, mm-hmm. and even how it ended, like, and it was so much truth within it. You know what I mean? And you know what I'm saying? It wasn't like even like the best movie, but it was. It's an A24 right. movie, and I like just about everything they dropped. But it was just something, I don't know. It was, yo, man. And I never seen Nicolas Cage on that type of time. So yeah, it was dope. It was dope.
They let him cut loose. See, like before we move on, because like I saw it last year, and I honestly loved it up until like the last like 30 minutes. Once the movie explicitly became about him yelling about cancel culture, I was like, okay, like you kind of lost the plot a bit. But like everything up until that was super dope. Just like the whole idea of like what fame can do to a person, and like, you know, like clearly this guy's like he's not a good guy, and like fame just kind of made him like a worse person. But it was just like real interesting to see. And it's crazy because like I love the ending's one of the saddest things I've seen in a movie in a long time. You know, like the whole dream thing happens, and then he like shows up in his ex-wife's dream, like in the David Byrne suit, and then he's just like, I wish it was real, and he flies away. Like that shit, like that stabbed me in the heart. Like to me, like if the last like 30 minutes of the film weren't as not great as they were, like that ending, I would have been like, that was one of the cooler things I saw this year. But I think they kind of fumbled a little bit. But it, you know, like once again, like, we do this because we care. You know, like they did their thing for the most part. But like, you know, because I think the guy who made it, it was his first. It was like his first writing directing job like ever. So you know, like there's some kinks that need to be ironed out, but I think it was solid. Like I enjoyed watching it, but you know.
Yeah. You said that was his first. That was his first film. The guy who did that.
Maybe not the first one ever. Let me check. Actually, hang on, because like I know it was like it might have been his first movie that he directed ever. I don't think it's the first one he made ever, but it was like, hang on, let me see.
Yeah, and I'm gonna be honest, bro. Bravo to that guy, because even the idea and the dynamic of having a script like, yo, let's make a movie where the motherfucker, everybody dream. It's just like, it was genius, but I think the genius part about it was how, especially in this day and age, my nigga, niggas will love you and hate you, like, quickly.
Yeah.
You know, especially for sure. Especially when there's no real content in them, like you, when it's some bullshit. I also think it highlighted how I think we're in an era in which I'm grateful that, you know, mental health has become such a big topic, but also it's become a crutch to certain niggas too. And people can use that against people. And like they were using that shit against them, like, I feel no, yeah. Like, and he became a fucking monster. He lost his job. He couldn't eat at a restaurant. And it was so many nooks and crannies to that film that I did like. I didn't like you said, like the last part of the movie when he was in Paris and shit like that. It was just like a little odd, my nigga.
Yeah, and it was like they had to iron some kinks out, but otherwise, you know, like I said, like a solid. It wasn't it wasn't his first movie ever. It was like the second one, but it was like the first like big one he did. But either way, you know, part of me kind of wants to watch it again, and I think I'll do that at some point. But let's go to the music. I think I'm gonna run it back at some point. But let's go to the music with you. Like, when did music become capital M music for you in your life? Like, when did it go from being like a passive thing to like?
I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, my fault. When did music become capital M music for you? Like, when did it go from being like a passive thing in the background to just like, or was it ever a passive thing in the background for you?
Yeah, I feel like, as far as my love or me actually doing it,
your love. We'll get to you making it in a bit. But like, when did it? What? Yeah.
Shit, man. That's a great question. I'm trying to see. I would say around middle school, because you know music has always been a part of my life. From you know being Nigerian American, both of my parents immigrants. You know, right. Bumping with Sunny Ades and the church music. Then, you know, I'm the youngest of four and I have three older sisters. So I grew up hearing the SWVs, the R&B, the Zanes, and the gospel vibes and shit like that. But I think when I was able to like buy my first bootleg CD, and that was like, the mixtape era shit. And I remember, that's when I realized like I really love this shit, because I wouldn't buy lunch. I would save my lunch money and buy a bag of chips during lunch, and I'll use that $5 to buy like two CDs from Downtown North or from the barbershop type shit. And you know, that's when I realized I really love this shit. So whether it was like the Funk Flex freestyles, the DJ Clues, the Big Mics, or the Blueprint 2s, or you know, the fucking instrumental beat tapes. And I think that's when I really was like falling in love with hip hop, but I think I fell in love with music low key. My sister had this Anita Best Of CD, and bro, like I would fall asleep to it every night. And I think I was probably like 11, 12. And I was just like, and I started writing poetry and raps a little bit, but I was like, how can I make my music feel like this, my nigga? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
And to this day, Anita Baker's still my muse. My wife knows this. She gets it. But, but to this day, like, just, you know, she's fucking amazing, you know? So I think around, you know, my early teens, around from, like, I say 11 to, like, that 11 to 15 era, you know, middle school to high school, that's when I really understood, like, I'm good off popping a PS2, nigga. I'm listening to this music, you know, I really became like my homies realized, yeah, moves the music, nigga, type shit. So, yeah, early teens, that's when I really understood, like, I'm falling in love with this shit.
That's so real. And you know why that's so real? Like the shit about you like saving lunch money to go buy CDs, because I used to do the same to go to the movies. Like I would get lunch money and then I would use whatever I had left over to go catch movies at the end of the week. Yeah. So I get it. Yeah. But you know, also like obviously like I was like really into music too. And I would, and you know, like I would buy CDs whenever I got the chance, and you know, like, and then of course like LimeWire and stuff happened. So I start downloading off iTunes like crazy. But either way, like that's you know, like that's because I was reading about you growing up with older sisters and kind of like embracing yourself, kind of like immersing yourself in like their music and then kind of finding your own.
Yeah.
And you know, like and like jumping from there, so like you know, like you become like Moo becomes the music nigga. Like moving from there, when like when did When did you know music was going to become more than just a hobby for you and something that you were going to like pursue and turn into a like a life pursuit type shit?
Damn, my nigga, a life pursuit? If you want me to keep it a bean with you?
Sure, bro. That's what we're here for.
Like I'm going to keep it up. So it was something which I loved for years, right? So
yeah.
Let's say high school, I came up on some battle rap and shit. First and foremost, I started writing poetry in middle school. I wrote a poem about 9/11. My teacher pulled me aside and was like, wow, MoRuf, this is really good. And I was just like, oh, shit, you know, especially growing up in the city, I didn't make the basketball team, my nigga. I'm still nice. But I was just like, okay, this is something that I'm good at. So I stayed at it. Then I'd say high school, I got into my battle rap and shit heavy, bro. Smacking yeah. DVDs. I'm talking about guns and killing niggas that I never touched. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But I think freshman year of college, that's the first time I recorded at an official studio. And I want to give a shout out to my brother, DJ Dozen. The nigga was like, come to the studio and for like 2 years. He just paid for my studio time, myself, my brother, EJ, and Nils. And that's when I fell in love with making music. Like, oh shit, what's reverb? Oh shit, oh, not that, you know what I mean? Oh, a drop on a beat. And that's when I first fell in love with the act of actually making music over just rapping on a street corner type shit.
Right.
And I became addicted to it. So, but even doing that, so then I dropped my first project, Ready to Live in College. Great. Yep. I dropped my second project, Shades of Moore College. Great. I do a little tour. But even then, my nigga, I graduate. I'm still working a 9-to-5. So it was still a passion, but I was still a part-time rapping ass nigga, bro. So, and if I'm being honest with you, Dylan, I didn't really take it as a true pursuit until 3 years ago when I quit my job. If I'm being honest with you, bro. If I'm being complete, and when I tell people that, they're like, fuck out of here, Moo. Like, Shades of Moore, that shit dropped 10 years ago. That's a classic. Ready to Live. Yeah, it is. But my nigga, I was not pursuing. I was still a little bitch in sense of I still wasn't giving it my all, you know? And I don't think I started giving it my all. Let me give myself more credit.
Yeah, please.
All right. Let me get. I'm sorry.
No.
I wasn't giving them my all. All right, I'm listening to myself. Like, nigga, you wildin'. Like, I was giving them my all, but it was still something in which I was just like, I'm not sure this is something which I can support myself doing, and it still was like giving hobby vibes because, nigga, like, my phone is off, nigga. You know what I'm saying? But I'm killing it. You know what I'm saying? But I think, you know, around Shades of Moore, the second project, that's when because I thought Ready to Live was going to take me out the hood, right? But it didn't. Then the second project, that's when I was like, okay. Then I think from there, I just took seriousness, like, I could do this for a living, like, and I say that in sense of like, how can this be lucrative? And I didn't start thinking about that till like a few years ago. Because I'm so about the art, my nigga. I wasn't thinking about bread and da 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 da. Nigga, I love art.
Right. You know what
I'm saying? I love making music. I love listening to music. So I got a little late to it. But I think once I got hip, I didn't look back. And I think that's why I'm on the type of time I'm on now, because I've learned so much the past 10 years plus. And that's why it feels like it's the beginning, because I'm like, oh, nigga, it's go time. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I don't know if that answered anything, but you get me.
No, it definitely did. And I appreciate you bringing that up because, you know, I mean, like most of us who are here, we're doing this because we love the art and we want to contribute to it in some, in like whether it's creating it or talking about it or like contextualizing it or like creating like an archive, whatever, you know, like I think that's important. But at the same time, you know, like we got to live at the end of the day, you know, like money needs to be made, you know, like kids and loved ones and partners need to be fed, you know, like you need to be housed, like all this other shit. So like, it, you know, like it's a, you know, like not to, not, you know, like not to say that your heart wasn't in it, because clearly it was, like you've been making music for like over a decade before, you know, like before everything else that's been happening now. But, you know, like you're at a point where you said you literally just quit your job 3 years ago. I didn't even know that, you know, like, that's how you know it's serious, when it's like, yeah, like this is like, I'm a lifer now. Like this is like, it's not just like a thing I want to do that's like fulfilling me creatively. Like you're here and this is like the thing that's gonna feed you, or like the, or like you're hoping this is the, gonna be the thing that feeds you. And you know, like it's like, so it's just like, I'm happy you bring that up in the way you bring it up, because you know, like you've always straddled the line between like different kinds of music, like particularly like R&B and rap, you know, like I go back to Garden State of Mind, when you're like comparing yourself to Chuck English on Daryl Strawberry, and just like balancing between like kicking back and maintaining mental and spiritual clarity on Respect 94, or like ending Soul Hop with like the piano cover of Brandy's I Want to Be Down on Shades of Moo, you know, like this is always, you know, like you've always been on this type of time, bro. Like, and I feel like that's been like a recurring theme of your music, is like just like juggling and like reconciling these different aspects of yourself as like a rapper and a singer and a human being. And like now knowing that you kind of, that, you know, like you, that you, that, that it took you up until 3 years ago to be like, to like, for lack of a better phrase, like fully commit to it. Like, I think that makes it even stronger and more powerful. So I guess just like, how is this manifested, like I guess across project to project, like how is that urgency manifested for you, like from project to project, or I guess from like era to era in your life? I hope that question makes sense.
wait, reword it again, because I want to, I see where you're going, like, wait, say it again.
So I guess just like, how does, you know, like you, like, I think like a recurring theme of your music is how you reconcile all these different aspects of yourself, like from song to song. And I guess just like, how do you, was that manifested to you, or how is that manifested from project to project? Like, is that something that you've like consciously thought about while making each of these projects? And were you thinking about it more then and less now, or less then and more now?
Yeah. I think about it more now, to be honest, because I think, you know, the first project, like I said, first and foremost, my first project was a prelude. So it was me rapping on Brooklyn. It was me rapping on a rah-rah beat. It was just like me rapping on a bunch of shit. So my whole point is, I just want to show niggas how to rap. But like, we're Ready to Live. I named it Ready to Live for multiple reasons, because my father passed the year before, and I was really trying to, I don't know, I was just on a different, I was at the point of my life in which I'm like, oh shit, we all gonna die. that's when it hit me. That's when it hit me, like, you know, after my father passed, it hit me like, oh shit, son, we all gonna be out of here. I have to create things that outlives me. Like, what the fuck can I do? You know what I'm saying? So I was on that type of time, so I really took all I had into Ready to Live. Like, nigga, broke as fuck. I made that shit on my mother's computer. You know what I'm saying? Mm. I was taking a train to Brooklyn. My home, you know what I'm saying? But we made that happen. And I was just listening back to it a few days ago. And I'm like, yo, this shit gas. Like, it's still slack. You know what I'm saying? Till this day. And I think it makes sense. And I think even with Shades of Moo, I think I got to a point of like, I know I can rap. Everybody know I can rap, but how can I make this a good album? Like, I don't want people to look at the cover and be like, oh, this nigga a rapper. Like, I want niggas to look at the cover and be like, is this nigga a singer? You know what I'm saying? And that's when I started getting into jazz.
Right.
That's when I met my now wife. You know what I'm saying? So I was good. Yeah, I was in my relationship too. I was trying to figure it out. You know what I'm saying? So it was really like a coming of age for me. And I think Ready to Live, that was like my era. You know, that's why, I mean, Shades of Mo, that's why I called it Shades of Mo, was really like aspects of me. And that's why I did have songs like Soul Hop. And that's why I actually put the genre under Soul Hop. And that's when I was getting into my vocal shit a little bit. So I'm not sure if I'm answering this fucking question at all, but I think each project, as I look back, I unintentionally manifested certain things. And that's why even the album that will be dropping at the end of this year, that's why I was very, very intentional with the energy I put into that, what yep. I was saying, because my nigga, like, a lot of the songs that I listened to, like, a lot of shit came to pass. So, and just the energy and mindset I'm on right now, you know, I find it to be very important to, like, obviously show niggas I rap, but, like, being intentional. And I think as I got older, like I said, Ready to Live, I'm just trying to show niggas I rap. Shades of Move, I'm trying to show niggas I'm an artist. You know right. what I'm saying? And I think I became even more intentional. And I think with the album that will be coming out later this year, titled Melodic, oddly enough, bro, I feel like it's Ready to Live. Like, it's not, it's like, it's a, re, it's really, I really feel like I had an ego death. And yeah. it's a real, it's a, my nigga, it's not, I'm not gonna say it's Ready to Live 2.0. But it's like a reintroduction of MoRuf. It's fucking it scary how
there it is.
My nigga, it's so fucking scary how aligned this shit is. And that's part of the reason why I'm, like I said, not to sound like a vocal record, but that's why I'm taking this shit so serious, Dylan. Because I really feel like the universe and God was like, I'm gonna give you another go, nigga. Cause it's a lot of niggas I started with who are burnt the fuck out, or they had their rise and 2013 are niggas who just lost the passion. So yeah. the fact, nigga, I'm 13 years in, and I love this shit even more, and I'm getting better. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Like,
no.
That's what I'm doing on Instagram.
See, I'm happy. See, I'm happy you brought that up too, because you know, like you know, like we said before, like you know, you were coming up, like. You know, you've been at this for a while, and like anyone who's able to like maintain not just passion but like a base yeah. for a decade, yeah. and like and like people wanting to hear your stuff still is like it's you know, like that's an achievement, and you know, like you've gone from stuff like the Romantic Movement to kind of rubbing shoulders with people like Sifu and Quelle and all these other people we were talking about before. You know, like you're I think one of your talents outside of like the fact that you're just like dope as shit at like rapping and making music is like you're really good at community building, and that's something that's going to help you live even more than anything, really. You know, I just think it's like I just think that's dope. You know, like that's not an easy thing to do. And yo, to like, you know,
you hit it right on the head, Bella, and it's crazy. Me, damn, this nigga about to make me cry. Like, this a lifetime special shit. Now, cause my nigga, I've been in LA for 5 months. Yo, Bella, the shit I was able, and I give all thanks and praise to the Most High. But it's based upon I came to the realization, like, oh shit, I am a community builder, like. You can place me wherever the fuck I'm at. And I'm going to try to build with the people, because my first intention when I build with niggas is not let's cook. I'm like, how are you?
Yeah, there it is.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, how you doing? You know what I mean? And I love people as much as I love art. So, and I realized even when I was cooking with certain homies, I'll be being honest, say the movie out 2013. I have not dropped a full of project since 2013, bro. And the fact that people still, you know what I mean? I was able to, people still fucking, you know what I mean? Still respecting, I'm still, it's just like, I gotta look back and like, what the fuck was I doing for 10 years? But I think it was a sense of like, just growing as a man, becoming a father, becoming a husband. Like I said, just, you know, figuring shit out, but it's just, this shit is nothing, bro. But I'm just grateful, super excited, like, even to be in LA, just had a release event, just did a performance with Leaving Records, building other shit, some jazz playing, it just, bro, I don't know, I'm just grateful, my nigga.
Yeah, I get it, you know, like, it's any, you know, like anybody should be so, like I said before, anybody should be so lucky to like still be like sought after like 10 years. And yeah, you know, like you figured it out and you're here and you took your time and you're here and people still want to hear it. And like, I'm happy you brought up everything with your wife before, because one of my favorite songs on Tiny Mic Raps Volume 1 is I Think I Love Her. Just like,
wait, Dylan, my fault, hold on. I literally bumped into somebody. Hold on, my fault. What's going on? Good. How you doing? Good to see you, yeah. Love. My fault. Random.
Nah, bro. You see, nah, this is at the community building shit we're talking about. Yeah. That's beautiful. But yeah, no. So like, I Think I Love Her is one of my favorite songs on this project. And like, you know, like that's clearly about like, you know, like you and wifey linking up for one of the first times and like you realizing like, oh yeah, this is it, you know, like, and the thing that gets me about it, like, yeah, the thing that gets me about it is that at the very end, you're talking about riding back home on the Long Island Railroad. And as somebody, as somebody who's been doing this for the last 10 years, I'm literally talking to you from my partner's apartment on Long Island right now. Like we've been together.
What the fuck is going on? That is mad random, son, bro. That is son. So I know that shit hits your spirit when I say that LIRR. That bar has to.
Yo, they better name a wing around Ronkonkoma train station after me, bro. That's how often I'm out here. Like,
nigga, likewise, bro. I'm a nigga from Jersey, so I remember the first time I went to Long Island and she checking, you know what I mean? So the LIRR, seeing them, the white drunk niggas at like 11 p.m.
Oh,
when they used to, you know what I'm talking about? When they used to have a pizza spot at Penn Station before they redid it.
Exactly. Like, yeah, you see me. You get it. You get it. You get it.
Nah, man. One million percent, my brother. Like for sure. It's kind of crazy. And it's like I said, it's really based on a true story. Like I remember when we linked up, I was open as fuck. You know what I mean? And Jody, listen to the song. Like Jody, she knew what she wanted. And we caught a crazy vibe. And I'm cool. I'm happy that people definitely appreciate that. And even after life, I guess I'm especially now, I'm at the point within my artistry, because I'm aware of how skilled I am and how skilled I want to become. But I'm seeing the importance of conviction and truth within your art. And being a former battle rapper, like I said, skill, so important. But some of the illest rappers, speakers, pastors, that level of conviction, you know what I'm saying? Some niggas might not even be that talented, bro. But it's just like, I believe you. You know what I'm saying? And I'm understanding how important it is to tell our stories through the music. And even as I'm falling in love with the arts more, and I've been writing scripts now, because I'm kind of understanding, like, nigga, you are a writer. Like, I Think I Love It could be a short film if I wanted it to be. You know what I'm saying? And I'm really feel like it's just about speaking your truth over, like, yo, this metaphor gotta be great. You know, that's gonna come natural because it's in my blood. I can't help it but to overthink bars because I love rap, but
yeah, of course,
you know what I mean. So it's just the fact that I spoke my truth, but it was something that you could connect with as well, or any man who, or any woman, or any person, any human who has feelings or had feelings or had, you know, how many niggas been open over a shorty or shorty open over a nigga? You know what I mean? So I think something which I'm learning with an art, and the reason why we love Spike, the reason why we love John, their ability to connect. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like, damn, that's us when we look at the screen. So I guess, you know, how can I tell my truth at the same time connect with niggas? I'm like, oh shit, that's me. Or when you finish listening to the roof project, you feel like, oh shit, I know this nigga.
Yeah.
You know, rather than like it sounding like the same nigga, that sound like that nigga.
Right.
It's a bunch of them niggas. You know what I mean? But I'm chatting, but you get the vibe.
Yeah, I think all that's extremely important because like and you know, like that's one of the things that draws me so much to Tiny Mike Raps Volume 1. Like just this whole, you know, like there's so much. I mean, like there's always been so much of you in your music, but here you're doing it in a way where it feels like, you know, like this kind of feels like a, like all these songs feel like little vignettes or like exercises where you're kind of like you know, like you're like trying out. You're trying out different flows, different like tones of voice, like going in over different types of beats, you know, there's going to be like one song, like, you know, like stuff like Say Less and Kerry James Marshall are completely different from songs like Alakazam or I Think I Love Her or like Mooboard, you know, like all of that stuff. Like, you know, you'll have like jarring shit where you're like practically like holding people's collars and like yelling in their face to you just kind of like being on your smooth shit, you know, like there's just like so much there's so much variety on this project, and this thing's not even this thing's barely 15 minutes long, you know.
12 minutes.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you know, so yeah, it's like yeah. you like your writing has always been super thoughtful and intentional, and just like, you know, like you wanting to put yourself on record, but like, you know, like the thing that I really enjoy about Tiny Mike Raps is how varied it is and how you're kind of trying to push yourself. And then on top of that, you also said that like your next project feels like it's a reintroduction. This is like the prelude to that, because this does, you know, like you're at a different point in your career now where people know who you are, but you're reintroducing yourself as like, you know, like you thought you knew me before. This is me now, you know, like as, you know, like as a man, as a husband, as a father, as someone who likes rap, you know,
yes.
Like,
yeah.
you know, like I can't think of a single battle rapper within the last 10 years who's made a project as good as this. Let me put it that way.
Wow. You know? I might have to, you're talking crazy right now, but yes, I might have to quote that. Don't get angry, but fucking thank you, bro.
Nah, man.
Thank you, bro.
I say that because the stereotype about battle rappers is that they can't put projects together, and you can put a project together. So like,
I appreciate that, and I think it's levels of taste, and also, you know, I think, and like you said, it's just like a reintroduction. I got to a point, like I think when I had my ego done around 2017, first time I experienced like depression the first time, and it's because I was holding on to like the old version of myself, and I kind of realized like, you gotta let that shit go. I think even Tiny Mike Raps, the album next, I'm more so like the nigga who rocking with me. I love y'all and I appreciate you. But I was so worried about, yo, what the nigga so fucking ready to live and change the mood thing. I'm at this point now of like, perspective wise, I'm thinking about the people who don't know what the fuck a MoRuf is.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? And
yeah.
my perspective has finally changed. I was so worried about, I was thinking small minded. I was thinking like a basement, you know, lo-fi, Jersey, local legend nigga. And that was cool. That was super cute. But I saw how far that shit got me. And I think once I expanded my perspective, I'm gonna still be who I am, but I've grown since then. And right. Now it's just like, I have to ask myself, Move, what do you want, nigga? Do you want accolades? Do you want comments? Do you want likes? And I'm like, I really want to make a living off of this art shit. So my perspective had to change. So I think now it's just more so when someone listens to Ready to Live, I mean, when someone listens to Tiny Mike Raps, I want them to feel like every project is basically an introduction.
Right.
You know, rather than, oh, this is Shades of Moon 2.0. You know?
Because yeah.
I realize every project with MoRuf is always going to be MoRuf. Regardless, if I'm doing some Alakazam shit, I think I love her. The DNA is always there. So it's just like, just give them the MoRuf of now.
Right. Yeah. That's tight, you know. Like I think you know, like I think it takes a lot of growth and self confidence to get to the point where, you know, like not so much that you don't care about what people think, but that you want, you know, like you just want yourself to be as, like you just want this, you want whatever version of you that you put out to be understood.
Yeah,
and that's and you know, and you're like that's. Like I think that's a perfectly valid and like a very human thing to want is like yeah. we all want to be understood. We all want to yeah. be appreciated. We all want to be seen. Like Ooh. Exactly, yeah. you know, like yeah. even if people don't want to be liked, everybody wants to be seen. You know, sure. like even if you don't like somebody, like at least you understand where they're coming from. Like most people can live with that. Exactly. Most people can live with that at least. But yeah. You know, I appreciate you being so honest and just wanting to, like, you know, just like have people take you, you know, to like bring people along on this journey and, yeah, you know, yeah. like treat every project as like a, you know, like as its own standalone statement because, you know, like, and it's just funny that this is, yeah, because like my last question I had written down was like, what more can we expect from like is Tiny Mike Raps going to be a series or is this just a thing where it's just like, okay, yeah.
My nigga, you know what I mean? That
yeah.
Volume, yeah. We didn't put that volume on this show because it sounded cute. It's really like, you know, how can we, it's funny. I started using a Tiny Mike during quarantine and just doing freestyles in my attic that got up to my brother, Jesse Wilkins, who's like executive producer Tiny Mike Raps in the album, and just a good friend of mine, a music collaborator, he was just like, I can elevate this, nigga. You know what I'm saying? Like, and nigga, we shot 8 videos. You know what I'm saying? So it's just like, these are one verse in and out. These are vignettes, audio vignettes. But rather than just be freestyling in my attic in Long Island, nah, nigga, elevate it. How can I elevate? And that's where I'm at. It's like, how can you remain who you are, right? But how can you elevate it, right, shit?
Yeah.
So that's what we did. So if it's like, you're hitting them with this. This is the first installment of Tiny Mike Raps. Then we're going to hit you with the album. Tiny Mike Raps Volume 2 will be, will drop when it drop. But I'm not going to hold you. I'm excited to. I think I'm at this point of this. I'm excited to, because I haven't dropped the project this Tiny Mike in years, bro. So I'm just at a point of, I'm excited to share again, number one. I'm excited to be consistent, number two.
Yeah.
And I'm just excited to like, yeah, just, I'm really standing on my shit, bro. Like, this ain't no like, oh, I gotta go to work. Nah, nigga, this is work.
Yeah, this is work. Exactly.
Nigga, this is work. And also, just my purpose is different. And I think I give that some shout out to Wifey and shout out to my daughter Nova. You know, just kind of when I got to a point of like, you know, I could let myself down, which is a bummer, but you know, you got people depending on you. And right. it's not even like, yo, I got to go crazy so I can get chicken. Great. No, I just want Nova to be able to see, like, yo, look at daddy and his back.
Yeah, you know,
type like, shit. It's not even like, yeah, we gotta pay bills. Nigga, we all gotta pay bills. I'm not talking about bread. I just want my daughter to see, like, yo, my father is in his fucking bag. Or even, I'm doing this for my daughter. I'm doing this for my mother who has shitty jobs coming up, but she elevated a month of years. But, and it's like, my mom ain't fucking struggle and wash floors when she got to this country so I could like be a pussy ass nigga. Like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, especially,
that's real.
I could have said it a little more intelligently, but I'm gonna
keep it. That's fine, bro.
You.
Yeah.
I'm gonna keep it a bit with you. Like, my ancestors and my parents, the niggas ain't struggle. Niggas, they struggle so you could take risks. They struggle so I could drink. So
yeah.
I think the personal growth, the fatherhood, like, you know, having conversations with my mom as I'm a parent now, just perspectives of relationships with homies, bro, relationships with homies breaking off. And I think personal growth, not to even sound corny, has plays a huge, you know, I think once I made myself a priority, not MoRuf the rapper, but just like, I did die off, I deal with me. You know what I'm saying? Like, die off, that's where my sisters and my family found me. Once I made myself a priority, I think, you know, and it took a while, my nigga. It took years. Like, you talking about projects about 10 years ago, bro.
But I
feel like I'm finally starting to see shit make sense. And I'm just like, oh, say no more. The foot is staying on these niggas' necks, Dylan.
And that's... I love to hear it, bro. Like, that's you know, like, like, you want to, and you know, like, and like I'm happy you brought that up about your daughter, because it really just is about, like, you know, like, you know, like, seeing you see her seeing you in your bag means that, you know, like, oh, like, daddy can do that, I can do anything, you know, like, just like that like, you want to instill that confidence in your kids and make sure that they can go even further than you did. I'm not a parent. I'm not a parent, but that's something that everybody should want, is to, like, that's aspirational to me, to, like, to be someone that people can look to as like a blueprint to take themselves even further, you know, like, we should all be so lucky to be that for even one person, whoever it may be, you know, like, that's such a gift to, like, be. So, you know, like, that's such a responsibility and a privilege to be someone's guide through anything. You know, like, that's such a privilege and an honor. Yeah, like, I don't take that shit lightly. You clearly don't take that shit lightly. Like, I'm about to go speak to fucking, like, UNC kids, like, on Zoom in 2 hours. You know, like, I don't take that shit lightly. You know, like, so I get it. You know, like, I get it to the extent that it can be God. But, like, man, wow, this was, I feel like we could go for another 2 hours, bro.
Nah, it's great dialogue. But the last thing I do want to say, I think it's the sense of, like, and I want to commend my, you know, my father and my mom. And I told her when I was quitting my job, when I was having a conversation with her, right?
Yeah.
I was like, Mom, like, you know, like, you know, you took a risk. And she was like, what you talking about? I was like, Mom, you remember in the 70s when daddy was like, yo, let's pull up to America. I heard that shit jumping. You know what I'm saying? Mind you, my mom was living a very comfortable life in Nigeria, bro. But she took that risk for the sake of us.
Yeah.
Her taking that risk allowed myself, my three other sisters, college graduates, we don't, you know, we're all in the field working with them people. But that would not have happened if she took that risk.
Right.
And I feel like me looking at what she did, it's inspiring me. And it's just like, I want, it took a while for me to, like, you know, but I finally got it. And I know my daughter Nova, my nigga, she's going to be her. Because she doesn't have to question, like, anything. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So it's just like, she's saying, like, you know, yo, daddy taking over, you know what I mean? And it's just, if I sum up this whole conversation, bro, it's power and getting out your fucking comfort zone. And I think that's what it comes down to. I was thinking about a good friend of mine, Sister Solana. I remember years ago at her crib, before she dropped any project, she was like, yo, Mo, I'm trying to tap in. I'm trying to really do this music shit. And I was like, go crazy. And I remember she used to, this is the era when I was, like, doing shows and nowhere for my homies from horror. Shout out to my bro, OGM and Edie.
Shout out to horror, Jersey's finest. Yeah,
those are my brothers. But more than anything, we kind of had North Jersey on lock. right? And I remember she used to come to the shows, da da da. But one thing I respect about Solana, and this, I'm about to connect everything. Yeah. The fact that she said, fuck it. She quit her gig, everything, bro. She just went all out. And even though I was, you know, kind of killing in the hood, I still was like playing it safe, bro. And my whole point is just like the importance of just falling 100% in some shit. That shit'll change your life, bro. Like, I tripped into NFTs. That shit is real, by the way. Because I quit my job and everything just started flowing. But my whole point is just like, it's just power and you're not your own way.
Yeah.
Comfort zone. So that's about it.
Yeah, nah, that's big facts. And yeah, no, nah, I'm happy you brought up SZA the way you did, because a lot of people don't know she's from Maplewood. Like, she's from our area, you know? Like, yep, that's like, you know, like, I saw her, I mean, I didn't get to see the show, but I was in the area when she played MSG for the SOS tour. And like, to see her name up there, like, you know, like, my mom used to stay in South Orange, so like, there was like a period of 2 years where I spent a lot of time in Maplewood, so like, I know where she's from, you know? And like, seeing her on the marquee, I was like, damn. Like, bro, you know, like, and you're like, it's like you said, you're like, you know better than anybody. Like, she took that risk. And now look where she is, you know? Like, she's an icon now.
She's like, her. She's
exactly.
She's all them shits, bro.
Absolutely, son.
It's power in that shit. And I was at the show. I was at the MSG show, and I was at the Perfect, I mean, the Newark show. And to be in that hood for SOS tour, and to really see that, it's just like, yeah, I'm so proud of my nigga. Like, anytime I see her, she's just over the crib before she just left the tour. And it's just like, I'm proud of that nigga. And I'm proud, beyond Solana, all of my homies. Every one of my homies who put themselves out there. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's a success, my nigga. You betting on yourself, it's scary as fuck, but you can either bet on yourself or regret it. So,
right. Yeah, who's gonna?
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Who's gonna look out for you if not you? At the end of the day, you know, like that. That's it, bro. And Mood to wrap this up formally. I'm really interested to hear your answer to this question. If your life was a movie, what would it be about?
If my life was a movie, what would it be about? Damn, I don't want to give away the script. Fuck. If my life was a movie, it'd be about like a man who. It'll be about like, this is a complex, nutty question and the answer.
Let's go.
But it's not even that nutty, I'm gassing it. But it'll be about like, it'll be about like a man who was consistent. He was a digger. He was always looking for like diamond stones, and niggas call him crazy. Like, what the fuck are you doing? Years pass, nigga still digging. What the fuck are you doing? Hair's getting gray. Mm-hmm. Fuck are you doing? One day, he's digging. He feels something. He hears that shit. And he looks at himself, hair drop, and that nigga say, I knew I wasn't fucking crazy. Type shit. And everybody is on dick now. I'm not saying that's my life at all. And I don't want my life. But... because everyone, I've always received love, which I'm grateful for. But my whole point is just like the man or woman who knew within themselves, I know it's something down there. He types it. Niggas might not see it, but I believe it. And I probably named the movie like No Biggie, Half Faith. Types it. You know what I mean?
Types. you know what's crazy? You just did a first on this pod. You named your movie. Nobody's ever named their movie on here before. So that, you know, you just set a standard.
Game a little bit,
bro. A little bit. But yeah, I mean, I love that answer. I love that you're at a point where you're feeling your most confident and that you've decided to bet on yourself, and that we all get to benefit from you betting on yourself. And I just want to say something like, thank you for coming here to do this. Thank you for wanting to do this. This is a great convo.
Amazing, man.
Honestly, it's been, I'm so annoyed that we haven't connected for real before this, but I'm just happy that, I'm just happy we're at the point. I'm happy you're at the point. What happened?
My fault. I told this lady I love her scarf. That's what was fire. I'm walking.
Nah, you're good. I'm just happy you're at the point where you're ready to, you know, like really go in and like tell people what's really good. With MoRuf, congratulations and thanks for taking the time, man. This is so dope.
Thank you. And I just want to applaud you real quick before we get off, man. Dylan, thank you for just creating the space, you know, being creative enough to put your love for a film. And this is this definitely goes in my top three favorite interview recently. Shout out to not the blog I did recently, but this is just because I love film as well. So this is how you even started it. You know, this was a great convo, and appreciate it, bro. Continue to do what you do, man. But
yeah, man,
creating a space for sure.
Nah, man, thank you. And yeah, I saw you shouted out my homegirl Nia and Lucky Seven, and like they're amazing. They're amazing over there. Like I'm a big them up every time. But I'm happy to be in that lineage. So just like thank you for. Nah, it means a lot, man. Thank you.
Perfect timing. It's kind of funny that I realized you're from Jersey, I'm from Jersey, and the fact this combo went so smooth, but this is not like first real chat. It's kind of nuts. And I just want to say, your IG names, elite, nigga, elite. You funny as fuck.
Thank you. That means more to me than almost not anything, but like I take those seriously. That's like therapy for me. That's just like my weekly venting. So thank you. Nah, like that's I'm gonna keep that on people's heads for sure.
Thanks for listening. Shout out to y'all for making it this far, and shout out to all the Black people listening too, because y'all really impeccable. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and tell a friend to come through next time. One.